The existence of oil has been known about since antiquity, but it is only since the beginning of the 20th century that it has been used as fuel for the internal combustion engine. And since then, its importance has grown with the advancing of modern progress. Today, it's the most widely used fuel in the world and the main source of energy for the whole planet, capable of influencing the entire world economy. Increasing necessity has forced man to refine research techniques and to exploit oil reserves, or rather those areas underground where crude oil is formed and is conserved with salty water and natural gas over the course of the geological eras. Shortly after the development of land-based activities, research on deposits under the seabed commenced. The first offshore oil rig was installed in the Gulf of Mexico over 50 years ago in 1948. Since then, the offshore oil business has grown continuously. Today, there are over 6,000 oil rigs located in the seas all over the world. They emit about 2.5 million tons of oil and 1.7 billion cubic meters of natural gas in the energy circuit. Alone or grouped together, small or enormous, some oil rigs weigh over 70,000 tons, hundreds of meters deep into the sea or near the coast. They are an integral part of the marine environment in many regions. The artificial latticework of the jacket, the structure resting on its underwater foundations, quickly integrates into the underwater ecosystem, becoming a meeting place and a protected area for different types of fish, algae, spirographs, coral, spores, madrepores, and mussels. There are over 100 oil rigs off the Italian coast, which provide most of the gas produced by Italy, around 18 billion cubic meters per year. Some are situated in the Ionian Sea and in the Sicilian Channel. However, they are prevalently located along the Adriatic coast at a depth of between 10 and 120 meters. On the 4th of November, 1999, the Environmental and Territorial Protection Ministry approved the project proposed by Eni to build the oil rig Emilio. It was to be located on the border between the Marche and Abruzzo regions at about 29 kilometers from the coast at San Benedetto del Tronto and at a depth of 85 meters. Eni aimed to exploit only the gaseous part of the deposit using two new wells. After 10 years of drilling, these reserves will dry up. The distinctive feature of oil rig Emilio is that it does not discharge waste into the sea. The gas and waste produced are sent by Emilio to a second oil rig, Eleonora, along two underwater pipes 13 kilometers long, and from there to dry land to the Pineto plant. In addition, there will not be a permanent staff on the oil rig, except for workers coming daily to Emilio to carry out routine checks and maintenance. ICRAM, Central Institute for Scientific and Applied Technological Marine Research, was assigned by Eni the task of developing and executing the program to monitor and identify any changes in the marine environment caused by the presence of Emilio and the two underwater pipelines connected to Eleonora. The innovative aspect of this project is that the control activities, which will be carried out over 10 years, were initiated shortly after production began, and it is supposed that up until now, the environmental impact on the surrounding area has been minimal. measuring and sampling activities will take place in 21 stations situated along two perpendicular transects, which have the oil rig Emilio at the center. Four stations have been positioned along the sea line, which connects Emilio to Eleonora, while another three stations are located in a more distant control area, which it is supposed is not affected by the oil rig. The water column is the immense container where most of the processes which regulate the entire marine system take place. The evaluation of the quality of the seawater is undertaken by the investigation of the physical and chemical parameters examined, which include temperature, salinity, pH, dissolved oxygen levels, conductibility, and fluorescence, and also through the analysis of biological and chemical samples. The samples of water are collected in special bottles called niskin. These are cylinders open at both ends which close at the various depths chosen to collect the samples, that is, near the seabed, at an intermediate depth and just under the surface. The niskins sit on a steel support. Additionally, a multiparametric probe is also assembled on the support, which is equipped with various sensors and is able to record continually the physical and chemical parameters. The probe is dropped at a constant speed the whole length of the water column and collects the information continually, which can be seen instantly on a computer screen. Once the instrument is brought back on board, the examination of the water samples begins. Various quantities of the sample can be collected directly from the lip of the niskin. In order to obtain the dissolved nutrient salts, the water is collected and filtered to catch any suspended particles, which would alter the following laboratory analysis. The samples are stored in bottles in polythene at minus 20 degrees centigrade until the laboratory analyses are undertaken. In order to obtain the suspended solids, at least 2 liters of sample water are collected and filtered. The filter made of glass fiber and used in the analysis of the organic and inorganic particles is conserved at minus 20 degrees centigrade until the beginning of the laboratory analysis. The information recorded by the probe is used to characterize the structure of the water column and to identify the various water masses. In order to discover the direction and intensity of the marine current and the spread of any pollutants, a current meter is used. The instrument is anchored to the seabed by an equipped line that includes self-propelled buoys to reascend, the actual current meter, an acoustic transponder, and a ballast. In order to obtain information regarding the current, a current meter is employed, which uses the Doppler effect to measure the course and direction of the current. The instrument emits acoustic impulses at a recognizable frequency. These are reflected by the suspended particles in the water towards an acoustic sensor that receives them at a different frequency. The variation in frequency allows us to discover the speed of the current at each point along the profile under investigation. About once every 3 months, the current meter chain is retrieved in order to download the information recorded on the memory inside the instrument. The information concerning the profile is represented using stick diagrams. These are vector diagrams of the current correlated to time. The intensity of the current is represented by the size vector arrow, while its orientation in relation to north is represented by the direction of the vector arrow. The sediments, the organic and inorganic matter deposited on the bottom of the sea, are highly unchanging and representative of the quality and the state of contamination in marine environments. The following environmental pollutants have been investigated in the EMILIO project: POPs, heavy metals, TBT, and PAH. POPs, persistent organic pollutants, have become increasingly important as indicators of industrial and agricultural impact on the environment. They're able to reach the marine environment through the atmospheric deposition and fluvial transportation. They display low acute toxic levels and high chemical stability, which determines their persistence and allows the accumulation in the sediments and in the biota. Heavy metals are stable and persistent pollutants that are not degradable, nor can they be destroyed. They also tend to accumulate in a particular way in sediments and in marine organisms. If a certain concentration of these substances is exceeded, they can induce toxic effects, particularly on the growth, reproduction, and composition of animal and vegetal species. TBT, tributyltin, is a widely used biocide. It is added to paints used on piers, the hulls of boats, and for fishing nets as an anti-vegetation agent. It is persistent and bioaccumulates readily, which means that it is often found in areas a long way from the source of emission. PAH, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbon, is formed after the incomplete combustion of organic materials containing carbon. It is present in aquatic environments. Its presence arises mainly from naval traffic and oil spills. Due to the fact that it is chemically inactive and highly persistent, it is now considered an ubiquitarian polluter in the marine ecosystem. Mechanical instruments such as corers and grabs are used to collect sediments from the seabed. A box corer was used in the EMILIO project to penetrate the seabed and collect the sediments. Each time the sediments are collected using the instrument, a macroscopic description is carried out along the whole depth of the matter collected. Three levels of samples are taken: a superficial, an intermediate, and the bottom level. The samples are stored in appropriate labeled containers. Simple plastic jars are used for the grain size analysis, and polythene or decontaminated aluminium containers are utilized for the chemical analysis. The aluminium containers are stored at a temperature of minus 20 degrees centigrade. The chemical laboratory analyses are carried out to evaluate whether there are pollutants present. Physical analyses are necessary in order to determine the diameter of the particles that make up the sediment, and thus obtaining important information concerning the characteristics of the seabed sediments. The benthos are organisms that live in close contact with the bottom of the sea. There are two distinct types of benthos: hard bottom benthos, to be found on rocky outcrops, and soft bottom benthos, which lives in sandy and muddy sediments. For instance, as we have observed in the area surrounding EMILIO, the benthos population living on the soft bottom is predominantly made up of polychaetes, clams and gastropods, decapod, stomatopod, amphipod, isopod shellfish, and echinoderm. The samples are collected mainly by a Van Veen grab. The action is repeated until a volume of around 50 liters is collected. The organisms are immediately separated from the sediment by rinsing them with running seawater through a sieve with a 1 millimeter mesh, which is fixed in a mixture of seawater and formic aldehyde. Subsequently, the samples are taken to the laboratory, where the animals are separated into different taxonomic groups and will be preserved in a mixture of distilled water and ethylic alcohol. The identification and counting of the various species and the study of the structures of the communities, number of individuals and number of species, will be undertaken using microscopic observations. Mussels are particularly appropriate subjects for monitoring purposes because of their ability to concentrate pollutants in the marine ecosystem in their tissues, such as, for example, heavy metals, pesticides, and hydrocarbon. They are able to filter up to 30 liters of water a day and can concentrate up to 1,000 times more chemical species than can be found in the water analysis, which are often difficult to collect. Are Mediterranean Mytilus gallo provincialis mussels. The mussel samples, representative of the population that colonizes the four legs of the oil rig, are collected by specialized scuba divers. The mussels are taken from the four legs and from different depths in order to represent the area concerning the oil rig as faithfully as possible. They serve as a bioindicator for the pollution problem. The use of clams is based on certain characteristics which these organisms have, such as the ease in which they can be collected and the in-depth knowledge about their biological cycle, especially their sessile nature. For example, mussels live their whole lives attached to the leg of the oil rig and therefore become a useful indicator concerning the quality of the water around the site under investigation. The depth at which they are collected is also important. This is because it could influence the metabolism of these animals and consequently also the concentration of chemical substances which can be found inside them. The mussels are brought as quickly as possible to the laboratory and are dissected. The information regarding the parameters of the shell, length and weight, and the weight of the fleshy tissue are recorded. This information supplies useful indicators regarding the state of growth of these animals and has become fundamental for a correct interpretation of the analysis results. After they have been subdivided, the tissue is preserved at a temperature of minus 20 degrees centigrade until it is needed for the chemical analysis. Offshore oil rigs influence the structure of the fish population by attracting many pelagic and demersal species. This effect can be compared to the similar impact that artificial barriers built for repopulation purposes have. It causes the original fish population to diversify, typical in sandy, muddy areas, with an increase in other species more commonly found in the hard substratum. In this way, a new, richer ecosystem is created. In order to highlight any changes in the fish population in the area caused by the construction of the oil rig, it's necessary to follow the evolution of the fish population over a period of time and compare it to the control area, which is not influenced by the oil rig. It is also necessary to take into consideration any seasonal variations. Continual sampling is therefore carried out over the course of the year in order to obtain sufficient information to highlight and quantify any changes by employing appropriate statistical analysis techniques. In order to collect the samples, two nets are cast at sunset and hauled in at dawn in the two areas. They are left in the sea for about 12 hours. Fish, shellfish and mussels found in the nets are counted and classified according to their species, and the size and weight of each specimen is measured. In order to obtain detailed information on the morphology and bathymetry of the seabed, side-scan sonar and multi-beam investigations are carried out. The side-scan sonar is used for the reconstruction of the morphological structure of the seabed, the distribution of the superficial sediments, and the presence of any anthropic structures. This instrument is made up of three parts. An underwater part called towfish or fish, where the transducers are situated. A control and graphic recorder, and a connecting wire between the two parts. This not only draws the fish in behind the boat, but also transmits signals from the transducers to the recorder. The fish is drawn in along the parallel transects at a constant speed, and it transmits sound waves downwards and sideways. Each point on the seabed reached by a sound wave becomes a source of diffracted waves, which are then picked up by the side-scan sonar transducers. All of the information obtained by the instrument is used to make up a photo mosaic of the area under investigation. Different shades of grey will appear on the final sonogram in relation to the intensity of the rebound energy. The multi-beam or multi-beam echo sounder is used to collect high-resolution and wide-scale bathymetric results. It is able to provide definition to the centimeter. The instrument is made up of a transducer, which is erected on the boat, and a control recorder unit. The multi-beam sends several signals simultaneously, which allows for a wider covering of the seabed. The results from the multibeam are used to draw up extremely detailed bathymetric maps and also three-dimensional models. The information from the SSS and the multibeam can be superimposed in order to obtain a more detailed map of the seabed. Once the sampling has been carried out, the boat returns to port. The oil rig is left alone in the middle of the sea. The results obtained from the measurement and sampling activities allow us to outline the environmental situation around the oil rig Emilio and along the sea line connecting it to the oil rig Eleonora. This, however, only represents the beginning of the monitoring project, which will last a total of 10 years. It will only be possible to establish if oil rig Emilio has had an impact on the surrounding marine environment at the end of the project. The monitoring carried out in the area concerning the oil rig and along the sea line will provide useful information for the drawing up of guidelines to follow and use in offshore activities. These guidelines aim to contribute to an exploitation of the Earth's resources in a manner which has less impact and is more compatible with the environment.